One of the main tactics used by the Germans in North Africa was to use machines like this to lure the British tanks into a charge against prepared defences. So the 88mm anti-tank guns would lie in wait, and little tanks like this would lure the British into battle to find that they'd been dragged into a killing zone which had been prepared with anti-tank guns. In 1941, if you were in the Panzer Corps, you would, and a driver would sit in here. As you can see, again, he's got a very limited view of the world. In action, this would actually be closed down, and the driver would rely on these two tiny holes here for his view of the world. The commander had a reasonably good view in normal situations, but again, in action, both of these hatches would be closed, and the commander would rely on a little periscope in the middle here for his view of the world. So, vision, as always in armour, is very limited. And the main thing about this tank is it has very, very thin armour for the period. It was already effectively obsolete by the time of the desert campaign.
In the early phase of the desert war, the German Panzer III had only 30mm of frontal armour, and the Panzer IV had even less at 20mm. Both of these machines could easily be pierced by British anti-tank weapons. In contrast, the early Crusaders enjoyed 40mm, while the doughty Matildas had double that at 80mm. The 50mm gun of the Panzer III could not pierce the armour of the Crusader, except on the side, while the armour of the Matilda could not be penetrated even at ranges as close as 500 metres. Despite the limitations of his armour, Rommel's conduct of battle was bold and resourceful. In panzer attacks, the tanks would be used as a wedge, the Panzerkeil, closely supported by other services. Artillery to soften the objective, pioneers to deal with obstacles, infantry to take and hold ground, and of course, the Stukas to act as supplementary artillery. Rommel led from the front, specialising in the concentration of a superior force against a single point, saying, "Kotzen nicht kleckern," in other words, spew, don't dribble. Where the Africa Corps had the definite edge on the British was in anti-tank guns. By 1941, the early war 37mm anti-tank gun had been replaced with the larger 50mm PAK-38. The Germans also employed the famous 88mm anti-aircraft gun in the anti-tank role. This gun could even take out the sturdy Matilda at ranges of up to 2,000 metres. Placed defensively, Rommel could use a screen of 88mm guns to knock out British tanks before the panzers were even engaged. This innovative use of weapons substantially reduced the advantages which came from superior numbers of British tanks. A major difficulty experienced by the British tanks in the desert was the lack of a dual-purpose gun which could fire high explosives as well as armour-piercing shells. The two-pounder anti-tank gun, which was standard in the British tanks, could not fire the effective high-explosive shells which were required to deal with anti-tank guns and infantry on the battlefield. This problem had actually been foreseen prior to World War II, and the interim solution was to provide two close support tanks for each squadron. Fitted with a 3-inch howitzer, the gun was of low velocity and short. Used mainly as a means of laying smoke screens, the close support tanks carried few high-explosive shells on board. Generally, the Crusader was used in this role.
Instead of the normal 2-pounder gun, which you found in every British cruiser tank of this period, this one is fitted with a rifled breech-loading mortar. And it's known as a close support tank. That means it's there to give support to the fighting tanks. Now, close support, in British terminology developed before the war, meant literally firing smoke shells. The gun is perfectly serviceable. It's quite capable of firing a high explosive round. But for reasons of tactical dogma, as far as I can see, they were actually provided with only 4 high explosive rounds and 20 or 30 smoke rounds. So here you've got a tank, the whole purpose of which is to trundle about the battlefield making clouds of smoke. It really does seem a bit ridiculous.
The importance of the supply system extended to the recovery of tanks from the battlefield. Not all tanks knocked out by enemy fire were actually destroyed. Often they were brought in to be repaired. Those not immediately repairable provided much-needed spares for others. At the same time, the enemy had to be denied the opportunity to use the battlefield losses in this way. Repaired enemy vehicles could be pressed into service against their original owners. And enemy equipment salvaged from the battlefield provided intelligence on the latest vehicles, armor, weapons, and ammunition.
This is the back of the Tiger, and obviously this is the place where the enemy would most like to get to, where the armor's thinnest, and where the machine is the most vulnerable. It also has some quite interesting features, because behind me here you can see this massive steel tow rope, which would be used either to pull this vehicle out if it got bogged down, or on occasion another vehicle, although technically they were forbidden from doing that, because the strain of pulling another Tiger on a tow rope would often ruin the engine of the first Tiger. The official regulations that they were supposed to wait for the breakdown truck to come and tow them out, but there were very few of those, and in any event they were unlikely to get into a minefield or into action. So the crews of the Tiger were very concerned about breakdowns and how these vehicles would be retrieved, so they actually often hung these steel ropes in position ready to pull their own vehicle or to give assistance to another vehicle in action.
The recovery mechanics and tank transporter drivers of both sides often plied their trade under fire.
In the event that your Tiger did break down, this is what you needed to be able to move it. This is a FAMO prime mover. In addition, there was also a recovery version of this, which had a huge spade on the back, which would dig into the ground and give it the anchorage it needed to pull the Tiger. In practice, what they found was you actually needed three of these vehicles linked together to effectively move a Tiger. So it was a difficult operation, and as you can imagine, these were in fairly short supply, and a big target like this isn't necessarily going to be taken onto the battlefield with any degree of safety or certainty. So it was a real problem if they did bog down or couldn't be moved for any reason. These were always in short supply, there were never enough of them to go around, and there were a great deal of other tasks that they were required for. They were the prime movers, for example, for the biggest guns in the army. And they needed to manufacture as many of these as quickly as they could to make the army as mobile as it needed to be.
In the Halfire Pass battles, the British lost 91 tanks, which included 64 Matildas. A considerable number of these were due to mechanical breakdowns, but a combination of time and shortage of transporters meant most ended up being left on the battlefield. In this instance, the Germans were able to utilise the captured vehicles. Rommel himself utilised this captured British armoured command truck, which he named Mammoth. In August 1942, General Sir Bernard Montgomery took over as commander of the British 8th Army. He was to reap the benefit of the new equipment and reinforcements pouring into the desert campaign. But Monty was a different breed of commander. He'd taken the lessons of World War I and the opening phase of victory in France to heart. He talked to his men, was seen by them, and gave them a victory at Alam Halfa. Montgomery soon stamped his positive personality upon the 8th Army. His son, the present Viscount of Alamein, recalls the galvanizing effect of his personality.
When my father, better known as Monty, went to the desert in August 1942, he found a demoralized army, which was standing on the brinks of the Delta, who were very battle-hardened. They'd been there for a long time. They were quite tired, and they needed a new face, and they were very suspicious of this new general who'd arrived. but he quickly inspired confidence by going round and talking to the officers, and I think that probably his initial address to the officers of the 8th Army was probably one of the most inspiring addresses that has ever been recorded. He wanted to make